David said, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He leadeth me beside the still waters. Not he driveth, but he leadeth me." God does lead us many times in strange ways and strange places. Sometimes the sun is not always shining brightly. This is Evangelist W.C. Raker, and I want to share with you our experience a little over a year ago when my wife was seriously ill, how that God answered prayer and fulfilled his promise. But first of all, I would like to go back to the summer of 1932 in an upstairs room in my father's house, 376 West Pine Street in Canton, Illinois. I'd just been on my knees praying and arose and took my Bible, and it fell open to the book of Acts, the 26th chapter. And the words of the 16th verse leaped out at me in blazing golden letters. These are the words: "Arise and stand upon thy feet, for I have appeared unto thee for this purpose, to make thee a minister and a witness both of these things which thou hast seen, and of those things in which I will appear unto thee." I turned around to see who was talking to me, and although no one was in the room, the voice was audible and clear. The reason I relate my call to preach was that during my wife's sickness, a little over a year ago, I gambled, as the world would say, my call to the ministry. We were in a revival in High Spring, Florida, and on Monday night, my wife, Mary, went to bed feeling fine, only to wake up the next morning seeing double. After a trip to the local doctor, realizing the seriousness of her sickness, we admitted her into the great hospital at Gainesville, Florida. They said they thought they would know what was wrong in about 4 days, but within 4 weeks, they were still debating whether it could be multiple sclerosis, food poisoning, or which they finally diagnosed as inflammation of the nervous system. After we admitted my wife to the hospital on Wednesday, in a couple of days, there began to be signs of paralysis going over her body. The eyelids began to droop. She lost her coordination. And soon her speech would be becoming impaired. And a little later on, the muscles seemed to die. There was not 1 ounce of expression in her face. Her eyes were set, she could only see just straight from the pupils, and was very serious. Well, of course, I was praying. The wonderful people at the High Springs Nazarene Church were praying desperately, Reverend Ray, the pastor, and all over the nation, we soon learned that our friends and churches were praying for my wife's recovery. One day, my wife asked me if I had received any promise for her healing. And I had to answer, I had not received any, although the Saturday following her admittance into the hospital on Wednesday, I had felt assurance in my heart that God was going to undertake. But I did not have a promise until the following week. One morning as I was reading the devotional book, the author had used as the scripture for this devotional day, lesson this day, was Hosea, the 2nd chapter and the 15th verse, which reads, "And I will give her her vineyard from thence, and the valley of Acre for a door of hope." The valley of Acre, the word Acre meant our trouble, for a door of hope. The Holy Ghost sealed that promise to my heart, and I went to the hospital that morning to see my wife. Taking the Bible that we had always used for our devotional lessons, I told my wife I had received the promise, and so I opened the Bible to read this promise to her. As I read it, "And I will give her her vineyard from thence, the valley of Acre, for a door of hope," I discovered that there was more to the scripture verse than the author had used in the Bible. So I read it. The remaining part of the scripture verse said, "She shall sing as in the days of her youth." She shall sing as in the days of her youth. Again, God spoke to me audibly, clear and plain. There I was standing in this hospital room by my wife's bed, and the patient in the bed on the other side of the room, just outside of the door, was the desk where the nurses and the doctors were as she was in the emergency room because of the serious condition she was in. And God's blessing hit my soul, and I hardly knew what to do. She shall sing as in the days of her youth. I was so filled with the Spirit of God and the blessing that I didn't dare to shout out. The people would think that I was crazy, which I wouldn't have cared, but there was a hospital full of sick people, and I just seemed to let off steam and let out the shout in my soul. God said she shall sing as in the days of her youth. There she was. It looked like her days of singing was over. Her days of usefulness was over. Her days of traveling and presenting the gospel of Jesus Christ was over. And now God had desperately, definitely spoken this word to my soul. Well, that night I went to church because I was still in the revival meeting. And after I got to the church, I stood before the congregation and I made this statement: if God doesn't bring my wife out of the hospital, then I'll never preach again. I didn't mean by that I was going to be bitter towards God because he should take my wife, but I meant by that, if God did not bring her out, then I was mistaken today in the promise that he gave me. I didn't hear his voice. The Holy Spirit didn't seal it to my heart. It was all wrong. And if I was mistaken in this, then I was mistaken back yonder in that upstairs room in my father's house when God said, "But rise, stand upon thy feet, for I have appeared unto thee for this purpose, to make thee a minister and a witness." And so, after I had made this statement, needless to say, we were put to the very test. The enemy was going to fight every inch of the way. And as I went back to the hospital after the service, my wife was not better but worse. And the doctor told me to get a special nurse for the night. And I knew it was serious when he asked for that. My wife doesn't remember it, but that night she told me she didn't think she would make it through the night. She was so weak and low. And so I made arrangements for the special nurse and went to the home where I was staying, Brother Hill, Fullwood, and family. And they, along with me, joined in with a special prayer for God to touch my wife that night. And so later on I learned, I didn't know it at the time, but my wife told me later on that the nurse came in ever so often through the night to ask her if she could swallow. They had emergency ready to give throat surgery that night, as they expected the paralysis to hit her throat. But the next morning when I came to the hospital, the first time I had seen any sign of a smile on our doctor's face, he gave me the news that he felt my wife had turned for the better. And of course, she did not leap out of bed and run the aisles and restored immediately. It had been quite a process, a long, drawn-out process, but God was with her, and the muscles began to rebuild. And after she was in there 5 weeks, then was released from the hospital, and then a little later on went back for checkup. We went back to the north for our revivals. She's now been back into the revival meetings, singing and playing with me, and for some time she was on a walker. The last night of our tent revival last summer, she felt she wanted to be anointed. We anointed her and prayed for her, and that night God touched her, and she has had no need for the walker from that day to this. We certainly have much to thank God for. And I must say that again, as I think back to that night that I made this statement, I tremble when I think about it, at how I gambled my call to preach, as I said the world would say. And yet I had no reason to tremble, and I was not gambling, when we realized that God's word is true. And the Bible said, "God is not a man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he should repent. Has he said and will he not do it? Has he spoken and will he not make it good?" And certainly God has stood behind his word And I'm sure that you will agree with me that God did not lie when he said, she shall sing as in the days of her youth, as you now listen to her.
Till the storm passes over. Hey! We'll be busy far away. There the saints will have his seal upon their foreheads, dressed in raiment none but ransom ones can wear. All who have the wedding garments will be present at that meeting in the air. There is going to be a meeting in the air, in the streets by. Be the